see all of you. I want to thank Lance Gary, the organizers, of course, for the conference, but I also want to thank all of you for being here and listening and being part of what I think is going to be a fantastic movement to get rid of nuclear weapons. At least we listen to Senator Markey and Representative McGovern. As we've heard from both of them, citizens have been at the forefront of reducing the risks of nuclear weapons. Not only was there the freeze movement in the 1980s in response to Reagan's call for buildup of nuclear weapons, and the invigoration of the Committee on Nuclear Disarmament in Europe, that freeze movement not only made a difference here in the United States, but arguably it led to the end of the Cold War, supported Gorbachev and Reagan in their interest in dramatically reducing weapons in the Soviet Union and the United States, and really changed the course of history. Before that, in the 1950s, we also saw a citizens' movement to stop testing, atmospheric testing. Doctors had found strontium 90 in babies' teeth and mothers' breast milk, and citizens were outraged that these weapons testing programs should hurt them directly and came out on the streets protesting that. And even before that, in almost as the birth of nuclear weapons, the citizens' movement of scientists was born at the University of Chicago. These scientists who helped build the nuclear weapon, the first atomic bomb, understood perhaps better than any in 1945, even before the first test at Trinity in July, that these weapons could incinerate people and cause truly horrific and extensive damage. And led by James Franck, wrote a report to the government saying that these weapons should not be used on civilians, they were indiscriminate, and that they should be tested first in a demonstration project to show the Japanese leadership how terrible they were, rather than first dropping on civilians. So from the very start of the nuclear age, citizens, scientists as citizens, doctors as citizens, mothers as citizens, everyone as citizens, have contributed to reducing the risks of nuclear weapons, reducing the arsenals of nuclear weapons. And most recently, we've seen another private group of citizens, the non-governmental organizations in the form of the International Campaign for the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons, organize pretty much the world to come up with a new treaty that would ban nuclear weapons through the auspices of the UN. So it's clear to me that citizens have enormous responsibility and have had enormous success. In fact, perhaps they've had, among all these bodies, the most success in reducing the risks from nuclear weapons. I will confess, though, that until now it's been difficult to see how Congress has actually checked executive power to build and potentially use nuclear weapons. So these recent legislative proposals, along with the earlier ones of the freeze movement, are really quite heartening. And especially the proposal to prohibit presidential first use would certainly curtail the executive power to launch attacks. Now, what has prevented Congress in the past from acting on clear citizen preferences for nuclear weapons reduction? There are two things I think that many experts point to as reasons not to allow non-experts, congressional members, as well as ourselves, to have any say in nuclear weapons policy. The first is speed. They suggest that in order to retaliate against a surprise attack, or even to deter a surprise attack, that you need to do it very quickly, and the executive and the military are the only ones who are able to do that. After all, Congress is a deliberative body. It was set up to be that way, to take many views into account. And it's just impossible for a legislature to be able to quickly respond to a dire emergency. The second is the question of secrecy. Since the beginning of the nuclear age and the development of the bomb in World War II, the expert community and the military have
developing weapons from our enemies. The irony, of course, is that our enemies quickly managed to get that information. And in fact, the idea of surface secrecy hasn't worked very well. Russians in 1949 tested their first nuclear weapon, and in 1953 a thermal nuclear weapon. And so it was really pretty easy for them. The knowledge was there. There wasn't much that the group was being kept from them. On the other hand, secrecy has prevented us, has prevented citizens and our representatives from gaining the knowledge we need about nuclear weapons capabilities and costs, about the war plans that are being constructed. And secrecy is often used to cover up mistakes and accidents, which further empower the executive branch. So we're kept in the dark, our enemies know a lot, and the executive enlarges its power. The result of all of this is that the people have no voice in the most significant decision the United States government can make, whether to destroy another society with weapons of mass destruction, and in turn risk being destroyed ourselves. Elaine Scarry brilliantly and rightly calls this a thermonuclear monarchy. Gary Wills refers to this as bomb power in a very short and effective book written in 2010. For Robert Dahl, a political scientist from Yale, writing in a book in 1986, Controlling Nuclear Weapons, he argues that citizens are really treated as children who are thought to have no expertise or knowledge and thus no right to participate in how nuclear weapons are developed and deployed. He suggests that we are, the people are, wards of the state, that we exercise the rights assigned to us only by the guardians of the arsenal, his phrase. Without congressional deliberation and citizen participation in the gravest decisions of life and death, democracy, of course, is greatly diminished, if we can even call ourselves a democracy at all. And our rights to life and liberty are completely abridged. Seems to me this leads to the complete disempowerment of citizens. If we can't make decisions about these most fundamental, consequential issues of war and peace, life and death, it undermines and trivializes our own rights and disempowers us, and I think it delegitimizes Congress, which is supposed to be our representative, if they cannot participate in the most consequential decisions that our country can make. So, what are the remedies? How can we change this? What can happen? Well, first of all, let's reduce the speed. There is no need, really, for the kind of speed that we people argued we needed during the Cold War, where we were worried about a surprise attack from the Soviet Union. So take weapons off of a higher status. This is Bruce Blair and several others. Bill Perry has also said that we need to reduce the launch readiness. In reducing the launch readiness, then you give a chance for more people to participate in the decisions about what to do in the face of an attack. Let's reduce secrecy. If we're going to make decisions about nuclear weapons, we need to know about them. The State Department in April of 2015 finally officially published the numbers of weapons and declared the numbers in our arsenals as well as those awaiting dismantlement. In May 2016, the Defense Department did the same thing. And thanks to experts in the scientific community, since 1987, we've published estimates of how many nuclear weapons and been able to inform citizens. And we published them in the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, and now they're available online from the Federation of American Scientists. Hans Christensen, I think, should be given a Nobel Prize, frankly, for making these estimates available. That's the only reason that we know how many weapons we have, the Russians have, China has, India, Pakistan. It's because of those informal published estimates. Another way to reduce secrecy is for congressional members and outside experts to participate in the nuclear cost review that the executive, the president, and the military conduct from time to time. This, I know, to many will be part of the decision making that we have a right to know what the war plans are. These are war plans that are in place, as you heard earlier this morning, every minute of every day. And yet we have no clue what they are. They are not publicly available. They are not something that we are allowed to see. But it seems to me if we're going to make intelligent decisions, feel empowered, that we need to understand more about these, and there must be some way to have some participation in this. Related to this is the idea of a liaison group. Both Senator Nunn and former Secretary of Energy Moniz, in a Washington Post article in September, made a suggestion that the chairs and the ranking minority members of key committees in both houses would review and oversee relations between the U.S. and Russia. They are modeling this on an earlier Senate Arms Control Observer Group that was established in 1985 by Senators Byrd and Dole, Democrat and Republican. These met with the Secretary of State and Arms Control negotiators in Geneva when we were dealing with the Soviet Union. They also had opportunities to meet unofficially and informally with the Soviet delegation. And it allowed congressional members, senators in that case, and in the case of the liaison group, congressional members, much more information and a kind of sense of what was at stake in these negotiations and how to talk to their own colleagues then in the Senate about the treaties that were being discussed and other foreign policy matters in the Senate. And finally, to return to Congress the authority to declare war. And that's exactly what the Markey-Lew bill is about, that Representative McGovern and now I hear 72 other co-signers have signed on to this bill. But clearly, as our representatives, Congress needs to have that power. You talk about education, healthcare, tax reform, and all these other things. It's very important. But the question of war and peace, of life and death, has to be the most important decisions they make and the most important decisions we make. The proposed legislation to limit the President's first use of nuclear weapons is clearly a necessary first step. But I think to move to what I would call nuclear democracy will take more than simply limiting the President's ability to launch nuclear weapons first. I want to quote a little bit at length from Gary Will's book, because as he said, this has been going on for a long time, this lack of participation by all of us. As he says, the whole history of America since World War II caused an inertial rolling of power toward the executive branch. The monopoly on the use of nuclear weaponry, the cult of the commander-in-chief, the worldwide web of military bases to maintain nuclear alert and supremacy, the secret intelligence agencies, the whole national security state, the classification and clearance systems, the expansion of state secrets, the withholding of evidence and information, the permanent emergency that has melded World War II with the Cold War, and the Cold War with the War on Terror, all these make a vast and intricate structure that may not yield to efforts at dismantling it. 76 straight years of war emergency powers have made the abnormal normal and constitutional diminishment the settled order. This is a daunting and complex agenda. There's no doubt about that. But citizens and their representatives seem to be awakening today to the dangers of the consequence, and perhaps it's time to take advantage of this very dangerous moment in which there can be opportunity to raise the awareness and move